mean, he was doing wonders and miracles in front of everybody. And Moses led them out of Egypt. And a few days go by and they start complaining, man, it's hard. It's hot out here, Moses. It's hard. I want some water, Moses. I need some food, Moses. I would rather, let's just go back to Egypt. We were better off in Egypt where we were slaves. Anybody ever feel that way? Be honest. Sometimes, man, I know I still deal with that. Sometimes it's like, you know, if I could just go back to my old way of doing things, I'd get this taken care of real quick. There's no going back. We can't go back, but we will persevere and we will strive on. So we've been talking about the difference between professing belief in Christ, what it means to be a believer, compared to what it means to be a disciple. Listen, there's a difference. Not every believer, not everyone who believes that Jesus is the Son of God is a disciple of Jesus Christ. It's scripture. In fact, there was a time in John, I think it's in John chapter 8, we won't go there right now, we've been there the last couple of weeks, but in John chapter 8 where Jesus said that multitudes was gathered around him. Many, many people, and it says many of the Jews believed in him. And so Jesus turned to him and said, saying, praise the Lord, our church is growing. Now he said, listen, if you abide in my word, then you are truly my disciple. In other words, what we're saying, multitudes came and it says many believed in him, but Jesus turned and he said, well, listen, not every one of you is going to be a disciple. Because in order for that to happen, you need to abide in my word. And I guarantee you, not everybody there was abiding. They might have believed Jesus was the sent Messiah, but they weren't abiding in his word. You know what the Bible actually says about you believing there's one true God? It says the devil believes the same exact thing. Amen. Yet he trembles in terror. There is a difference. Just like there's a difference between receiving the Holy Spirit and walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. Not everybody who has received the Holy Spirit is walking in that power. Not everybody who has come and confessed Christ as their Savior is walking in the authority of Jesus Christ. And not everybody's walking in his power. Jesus himself, when he was baptized by John the Baptist, the Spirit descended upon him, it says in Luke chapter 4 or chapter 3. The Spirit descended upon him, and it says, then the Spirit led him in the wilderness to be tempted by the devil for 40 days. And it was after that time of fasting and temptation and prayer that Jesus came out, and it says he returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. When Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit, that's when he began to teach in authority. He began to teach like in a way that nobody ever heard of before. You see, you had these Pharisees and these scribes and sages that were teaching the people that were regurgitating the things that they had learned, right? And they were teaching law. Well, this is how you get right with God. You got to do this, and you got to do that, and you got to do it this way, and you got to stop doing that. And they're teaching this law that saves nobody. And all of a sudden, this man shows up on the scene walking in the power of the Spirit and says, believe in me, because I'm the one that's going to put the devil under my feet and crush him, and I'm going to die for you, and I'm going to take your sins to the cross. And so it was all about Jesus, and he was teaching with this authority, and he began to heal people, man. Yeah. Blind people begin to see things they've never seen before. Deaf people begin to hear. Lame begin to walk. Dead begin to live. Dead men risen to life. This Jesus was walking. Now, in the gospel, up to the point of him returning in the power of the Spirit, you don't read of any miracles that Jesus did.
Amen.
Many of us want to confess Jesus as our Savior. Few want to serve him as their Lord. That's discipleship. So, 2 weeks ago, we visited the beginning of the disciple-making process. We were in Matthew chapter 4, where we seen that Jesus began to call his disciples. And the first thing that we saw there was when Jesus called his disciples, it says immediately they followed him. Immediately they stopped what they were doing. Immediately they left their old lives behind. Immediately they followed Jesus. And so last week we're talking about how we, when we receive the call from God, we have that choice to make. Do we trust him? Do we believe him enough that we're going to leave our old lives behind and actually follow him? Hi. Where was I? Thanks, buddy. We have to make that decision. Are we going to leave our old lives behind? And so last week, as we talked about this, we talked about repentance. We talked about leaving the old lives behind. Buddy, go find your sister, please. And it was a beautiful time 2 weeks ago because much of the church, not all of the church, but much of the church found themselves on their knees, on their faces, repenting, begging God for forgiveness. And turning from their old lifestyles, turning from their old lives. Most of us, I found myself on my knees right here. Because even as your pastor, I tell you, I don't walk perfectly. If I did, my name wouldn't be Rob, it would be Jesus, and it sure isn't. And so we found ourselves right here on our faces, repenting and turning from old lifestyles. But I know also that many right now are wondering, well, I was there, I was on my knees, I was repenting. Why aren't things changing? Why does it still feel the same as it did 3 weeks ago, when 2 weeks ago I repented, I did what I thought I was supposed to do, I fell on my knees in repentance. Remember that this was the very beginning of a process. The disciples, they made the decision to turn away from the old life and begin a new walk. They didn't leave the Father in the boat, get off the boat, start following Jesus, and all of a sudden they were getting everything right. Read about Peter, man. Matt, me and that dude, we got along great. That dude was always sticking his foot in his mouth. So there was a beginning. The beginning of their discipleship process was to turn away from the old life and begin to follow Jesus on a new path, right? Yep. And then we went to Matthew chapter 5 and we saw that Jesus began saying and teaching some pretty radical stuff, man. When I say radical, it means like Jesus was teaching his disciples things that were completely against the grain in that day, in those times. And what Jesus was teaching his disciples, there's still much against the grain of our own times and our own culture. So Jesus started teaching some radical stuff. Today, I'll go back to that Sermon on the Mount, as they call it, in Matthew chapter 5, if you got your Bibles with you. Beginning in verse 1, it says this. Seeing the crowds, he went up on a mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. I want you to get that first. It says that his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, so who's he talking to now? He is talking to his disciples, those who have decided to turn from their former way of life and begin a new life. He's talking to them, and he opens his mouth and he teaches them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sakes, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For as they persecuted the prophets who were before you, You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled upon under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Now, there are many teachings on exactly what Jesus meant in these, what they call the Beatitudes. There are many different opinions, many different things that people teach about the Beatitudes and what exactly Jesus was saying, but there is one thing for sure, and I believe it's the most important thing, and it is that being a disciple, being radical or radically changed, is less about your actions and much more about your heart. Amen. And we see that right here in the Beatitudes. In these first two Beatitudes, we look at it again, blessed are the poor in spirit and blessed are those who mourn. Some of us began to experience that 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. During the repentance message that we received, blessed are the poor in spirit. Those who humble themselves before God. Those who realize that they have absolutely nothing without God. Those who realize that they are in need of a Savior. Blessed are they when you realize that you are spiritually bankrupt. Blessed are you because now you will come to the Father knowing you need something bigger than yourself. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are they who collect for themselves all sorts of earthly things and still feel a big gaping hole inside of them. Anybody feel like that?
Amen.
No matter how much you do in the world, no matter how much you gain, no matter how much you collect, no matter how much money you make, how much money you spend, what you drive, where you live, there's still this big, huge gaping hole. Something is still missing. Something is still out of place. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Absolutely. Blessed are those who mourn. What does that mean? That is radical, you guys. That doesn't make sense in the world. Blessed are those who are crying or mourning, who are grieving. That doesn't make sense. I want to be happy. After all, you know what blessed means? No, blessed is so much more than being happy.
Amen.
Blessed is a divine type of joy that you can't get other than from God. And he's saying, blessed are those who mourn. What does he mean by that? Well, when you realize that you are spiritually poor, when you realize that you are spiritually bankrupt, when you realize that you have and are nothing without God, and you realize that you are full of wretchedness, you think back on the life you've lived. You think back on the things you've done. You think back on the crimes you've committed, the people you've hurt. You think back on all the sin you've committed against the holy God. That should make you mourn. To think of what sacrifice Christ paid, even while you were still yet sinners, ought to make you mourn. And like I said, praise God, 2 weeks ago, some of us experienced that right up here at the altar. Some of us thankfully humbled ourselves to realize that we are bankrupt without God. To realize that we are not capable of doing anything in this world to make ourselves right with God. The life you live should be sending you straight to hell.
Amen.
But praise be to God that He paid the cost even while you were in the middle of your wretched sin, that you can now come boldly to the throne of grace.
Amen.
And so, like I said 2 weeks ago, we found several people up here just mourning, crying out to God, humbling themselves before a holy God, saying, Lord God, I am not worthy of you. I'm not worthy of your grace. Guess what? None of us are. I'm not worthy of your mercy. But yet he loves me anyway. And so, just in the first two Beatitudes here, we see that there has to be this change of heart. There has to be a change of heart. If you look at James chapter 4, beginning of verse 1, it says this: what causes quarrels and fights among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war within you? You desire and do not have, so you murder. You covet and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions. You adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you suppose it is to no purpose that the scripture says he yearns jealously over the spirit that he has made to dwell in us? But he gives more grace. Therefore, it says God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Can you see that just in those first six verses? He's saying, what causes the war in you? What causes the strife? What causes the fighting? It's your own lusts. Yeah. It's your own desires. It's your own lifestyle. It's you wanting to serve you. When it's all about you, you can guarantee there's going to be strife in you. There's going to be jealousy in you. There's going to be envy in you. There's going to be all sorts of sin built up in you because you're serving your own desires. And so James points this out. He goes, what causes the fight amongst you? What about the fights in your family? What about the fights right here in your church when you're fighting with another church member, when you're fighting with another family member? When you're fighting with the other six voices in your head. Oh, is that just me? My bad. I'm kidding. he points it out. He says it's your own desires. It's your own lusts. That's what's causing these things. You're serving yourself. And then in verse 7, listen to what he says in verse 7. Submit yourselves therefore to God. My wife just told me the other day, and it was funny. I was at work a few weeks ago, and a couple guys at work, we were talking about how you ever hear a word that you haven't heard in a long, long time, and you hear it, and you're like, man, I haven't heard that in a long time, and then all of a sudden you start hearing it everywhere.
Yeah.
You know, it was funny because we were just talking about that, and one of my buddies at work, he was like, well, I know one you'll never hear again, and he went to that Mary Poppins super fat cow. Well, the three of us were in there, we were taking parts in the word, you know, once the super cala, and then fragilistic, and XPI. 2 days later, his cousin was like, dude, you're not going to believe this. He says, I was sitting there on the couch, and all my girlfriend stood up and just started singing supercalifragilistic, whatever, you know what I mean? And so it was funny. And then, so the other day, we were in the car, and my wife was telling me about this pastor she used to have who would always say that in the Bible where it says therefore, he says there's a reason that therefore is therefore, so let's find out what the therefore is therefore. That's kind of cool. I like that. Because we've said similar stuff, not that, but we said the reason therefore is there, you got to look at the scripture prior to what it's saying.
Right.
So that night I get home and I'm doing my studies and I happen to pop on a sermon on YouTube, and the first thing the first pastor says, he goes, well, the therefores are there for a reason, so let's find out what the therefore is there for. I'm like, man, it never fails. It was just funny. So, but I say all that to look at verse 7, and it says, therefore it says, That was in verse 6, I'm sorry. But he gives more grace. Therefore, it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So we have to look at it from back what he's saying. He's talking about these quarrels. He's talking about these desires that are in our heart that are evil, that are not godly, that are submissive to self and not submissive to God. He says, therefore, God opposes them. And then in verse 7, he says, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Now pay attention to what he says here. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves, therefore, before the Lord, and he will exalt you. Look at 8 again. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners.
Amen.
The Bible actually says that every single one of us has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's not a single one who does right. Not one who is righteous.
Not even close.
And here James says, cleanse your hands, you sinners. And that is what we were doing 2 weeks ago in our repentance. That was the cleansing of our hands. When we stop and we turn away from the sin and we turn back to God, he cleanses us. Because it also says in the Old Testament that you can sit there and scrub and scrub and scrub and scrub and you're still filthy.
Yep.
You're still dirty. It takes somebody like a holy God to actually cleanse you. And that only comes by us turning from our wickedness and turning to him in repentance. And so it says about cleansing the hands. And then it says, and purify your hearts. So that's where we go next. We repent, we cleanse our hands, we ask God to cleanse us. And then we have to have a purified heart, right? Or am I reading that wrong? Purify your hearts. In 2 Corinthians, Paul wrote, for godly sorrow produces repentance leading to salvation, not to be regretted. Listen, for godly sorrow produces repentance. That's that mourning that Jesus is talking about. Godly sorrow produces repentance leading to salvation, not to be regretted, but the sorrow of the world produces death, he said. And listen what James just said again in verse 9. Be wretched and mourn and weep. That's not the kind of instructions we really want to hear, huh? But it's important. Be wretched. Mourn. Weep for the things you've done. Fall on your knees. Ask God to cleanse you and weep over the choices you've made, over the activities that you've done. Psalm 24, it says, who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart. That pure heart is absolutely significant and important. And that's what we must understand from the Sermon on the Mount. If we take anything with us from the Sermon on the Mount, we have to take this. Jesus is calling us to have pure hearts. True discipleship will require clean hands and a pure heart. I want to go back, to the sermon and just kind of skim through some of it in Matthew 5. Look over at verse 21. He says, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. And whoever says, you fool, will be liable to the hellfire. Look over at verse 27. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. You guys, that's some radical stuff. Seriously, think about that. He's saying, look, Moses come up on a mountain and Moses told you, don't commit murder. You're not to commit murder. So what happens? Well, they try their best not to commit murder because they won't be righteous before God because they want to get into heaven when they die. Not because their heart's been changed, but because their actions, they're trying to change their actions. But guess what? Your actions aren't really changing because your heart is the same. Your heart hasn't changed. That's what Jesus is saying. You've heard it said, you shall not murder. But I tell you, if you're even angry with your brother, you're in trouble of hellfire. Because your heart hadn't been touched. Your heart had, and you're absolutely right about that. Your heart hadn't been changed. He says, you've heard it said, you shall not commit adultery. But I tell you this, if you even look, listen up, man, including me. If you even look at a woman with lust, you don't commit adultery with during where?
Your
heart. It's the heart that matters. It's the heart that counts. Now, let's be real, man. That's a doggone hard one. Don't even look at a woman with lust. That's hard. Women, it's probably hard for you not to look at women with lust. I'm kidding. Men with lust.
Men with lust.
But what's Jesus saying? Not, I'm going to tell you the truth. Okay, listen, I will tell you the truth. You have got pastors to tell you this is what Jesus was trying to raise the bar on the mountain. He was trying to make it so impossible that you would know you needed a Savior. Listen, you already knew you needed a Savior. Jesus wasn't raising the bar. He was telling you where to look in your heart to find out why you keep committing murder, why you keep committing adultery, why you keep stealing, why you keep doing the things you keep doing. He wasn't raising the bar. He said, I ain't come to get rid of the law. I came to fulfill it.
Yes.
He said, this is why. This is why it's so doggone hard for you to stop doing the things that Moses told you you ain't supposed to do. It's because you have a heart condition. And it's a condition we're all born with. David said, I was conceived in sin. We were all born with a heart condition.
Amen.
The outside behaviors were only the result of that heart condition. You might be able to sit in here and say, you know what? Bam, bam, I never killed nobody. Some of you might not be able to say that, but some of you, I hope some of you can say that. But let me ask you this. Have you ever been angry enough that you wanted to?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm, I have. That's sin. Why?
Yep.
Because you still got a problem in your heart.
Absolutely.
There's still a heart condition.
Absolutely.
Let me ask you this. Moses also read from the commandments that thou shalt not steal, correct?
Amen.
If there was something that you really, really wanted, something you really, really wanted it, but you couldn't afford it, but you knew for a fact that there was a way for you to take it and not get caught, you think you might? Because if you do, and if you're honest, if you think there's no way I could be caught for stealing this, then you have a heart condition. Okay, everybody's shaking their head. Let me hit one that's home for us in America. If you thought that you could commit adultery without getting caught, you knew there was absolutely no way ever that you could get caught at all. There was no possibility of getting caught. Would you do it?
No.
Good for you. But for most people, let's be honest, the answer is probably. It means that you have a heart condition. And that's all Jesus. I'm not asking you guys are personal. You know, everybody's shaking their heads, nodding heads. Let's get real, man. It's about a heart condition, okay? I'm not here for you guys to prove who's bad or who's good or anything like that. Let's not do that. My problem, or my thing is this. Our problem is in the heart. It's not with your actions. Because that's what Pharisees did. The Pharisees were the ones that were abstaining from things that they shouldn't do and doing things that the scriptures told them they should do. But the fact is they had an unchanged heart, and so none of that even mattered. It was religion. So if we're abstaining from things just because we know it's not the right thing to do, but it's not what's in our heart, it's still just religion and it's still worthless.
What do you mean worthless?
It's worthless. If it's not, it's not worthless?
It's a choice in your heart.
Okay, we'll talk later. But yes, it is worthless. If it's not changed from the heart, absolutely. If your heart is the same as it was before you came to the Lord, then your actions are worthless.
Amen.
We'll get there. Jesus told the Pharisees the same thing. If you don't believe me, hopefully you believe Jesus. So in chapter 6, verse 1, beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. Listen, he said, beware of practicing your righteousness. Beware of doing your rightful deeds in front of other people just for the purpose of being noticed by them, is what he's saying there.
Yeah.
If the reason you're doing good deeds is because you want people to notice your good deeds, guess what? You don't receive your reward.
Amen.
You got noticed. And that's all the reward you get. He says, but when you do your righteous deeds, you do it in secret. Don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. You do it in secret. And the Father who sees in secret will openly reward you. But those who are doing it for the pure purpose of their praise, for the pure purpose of being noticed, getting noticed is the exact reward they will get, and that's the only reward they'll get. Outward behaviors are performed from a selfish heart. That's kind of ironic, ain't it? It's like we're doing good things, but we can actually do good things for other people out of a selfish heart. For instance, if I was to say, hey, brother, I want to help you out this week and give you $100, but hold on, don't take it. I don't need everybody to see. You guys, look, this brother's down and out, so I'm going to help him. I'm giving him $100. Hey, Josh, I'm helping my brother out, man. Okay, now you can take it, brother. My reward, Josh saw. I've done that out of a selfish heart. You can actually do good works for other people out of a selfish heart. Absolutely. It's how we refrain from evil behaviors while still living with a stony and hard heart. If you're doing something good simply for the praise of doing something good, then really, you're doing nothing good. Let's look at 6:16. It says, and when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces, that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. How about this one, in 19? He says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasure in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. Listen to what he says in the next verse. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You see, all through this Sermon on the Mount, the longest recorded sermon that we have from the Messiah, he continuously is talking about our hearts,
yes,
about the condition of your heart. In 25, along with that one, he says, lay up treasures in heaven, not on the earth. In 25, he says, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather in the barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. And are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you a little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For even the Gentiles seek after these things. And your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. And then listen, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Seek, that's the heart, man. Are you worrying? Are you not trusting? Or are you believing God? Worry comes from an untrusting heart. Many go through the motions of serving God, but it's by the things they seek first that reveal their true heart. I love that, Matthew 6:33. Because many people can show up to church and sing praises to God and bow their heads in prayer and call themselves a Christian and talk the talk, but it's by the things they seek first that reveal what's truly in their heart. I'm going to tell you, man, right here in our church, when I see, I want you to say amen, when I see boys come in here for the sole purpose of trying to take a woman home.
B-O-Y or B-O-I?
Please.
The difference.
If you come in here, if you're coming in here looking for a relationship to get yourself into, and that relationship isn't with Jesus, you ain't coming here for the right reason.
Amen.
And I will call you out on it.
Earlier.
Seek first the kingdom of God. Now, I'm not telling you can never have a relationship, because what better place to find a relationship with another human than from the church, right? But, man, it's got to be in God's time, not yours.
Amen.
Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and the things that you're seeking. But see, what happens is many people want to twist that around and say it the other way. Well, seek first these things, and then try to add God to them.
Amen.
Let me come in here and find myself a relationship first, and then I'll ask God to bless it. It doesn't work that way.
Amen.
God will allow things to happen in his time. But will you? Or do you take them into your own hands? What are you seeking first? Is the question. That's what Jesus is talking about. It's what is in your heart. Listen, I'm not up here to condemn nobody. I'm right here with you guys, man.
Amen.
This is not an easy life. Nowhere in the scriptures does it say that this is going. Jesus say, follow me, I'll make your life easy for you. I'm going to make it to where everything you do is just going to be blessed and you get everything you ever wanted. He said, listen, if you want to be my disciple, you're going to be persecuted.
That's right.
And let's go to chapter 7, one of the most well-known verses in Scripture.
Yeah.
By the world, too. Judge not, that you be not judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, and there is a log in your own eye? Mm-hmm. You hypocrite. First, Take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. So now here, Jesus reveals that all of your actions, all of your works, all of your good deeds, he's shown us what is your intent. I'm sorry, I was reading that wrong. It's in this verses right here, he's showing us what is your intent. What is your intent toward a brother? Is it to condemn the brother because of the things that the sin that he's got in his life, or is it to lift him up?
Apparently you should call that number.
Because if you're walking around with a log in your eye and you're trying to tell your brother, hey, you got this, you need to take care of this, you got to fix this, you got to repent of this, you got this sin in your life, Charlie, you got to take care of it, you need to do it, and I've got this log in my own eye, then the log is probably the fact that I'm not talking to him to help him, to build him up, to bring him and help bring him to a place of repentance and solitude and coming back to God, but then I bring it to him to kind of use him as my stepping stone to put myself a little bit higher. What's the intent of your heart when you're pointing out the sin in the brother's life? Because let me tell you this too, as a Christian, you are called to judge other Christians.
Amen.
I don't care what the world tells you, the world ain't serving Christ. You, as a Christian, are called to judge other Christians, but it's with what kind of heart? What's the purpose of the judging other Christians?
Hold them accountable.
It's to build them up, to edify them, to bring them back into union with Christ. Never to slander them, smash them, push them down, and step all over them. But I'm going to tell you what Paul said to the Corinthians. He said that you should judge those within the church. He said God judges those outside the church. Don't worry about those outside the church. God will judge them. He said, but you are to judge those inside the church. Absolutely. But with what intent? With what kind of heart? It should always be with a gentle and kind heart in order to build up and edify the church, not to tear down your brother or sister in Christ. And 7 verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. If you won't fear anything, fear those words. Because what Jesus is showing us here is that there are going to be people who could have just could have swore they were going to heaven because of their mighty acts on the outside. Did you see what Jesus is saying here? No matter what works you do, no matter how great you are, no matter how good things you've done, no matter how much lip service you've given, if it's coming from an unchanged heart, it doesn't matter. It's the heart that matters. It says that there's going to be people who are casting out demons in the name of Jesus, and Jesus is going to say, good for you, but I never knew you. Now depart from me.
Ouch.
Oh, man, the words that people are going to hear that day. It has to be from a changed and purified heart. Family, listen to me. I'm not just up here to preach to you. I'm up here because we have a heart condition. Me, you, we have a heart condition. And if we don't do something about our heart condition, we are in deep trouble. Some of you just may be in danger of hearing those words, depart from me. See, the Pharisees, they were real careful in keeping the law for the purpose of keeping the law. They didn't understand what it meant to have a relationship with God. A relationship. What it means to have a heart transplant, as I like to call it. Because see, here's the other thing. A lot of people tell me you gotta change your heart. You need a new heart. You need a new heart. Your old heart is stony. It's hard. I will get there. God said, I will take out your stony heart and replace it with a heart of flesh. Hey, amen. Well said. So, good acts are not the cause of a pure heart. Good acts are not the cause of a pure heart, but rather they are the result of a pure heart. I'm going to go over to Matthew chapter 15. That one, Mark 2? Matthew chapter 15, verse 10, says, and he called the people to him and said to them, hear and understand, it is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but what comes out of the mouth. This defiles a person. The disciples came and said to him, do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this saying? I love that, man.
I love that.
The disciples came. Jesus said, it's not what you put into your mouth that defiles a man. It's what comes out of the mouth. And so the disciples come and says, Lord, did you know that you just offended all these goody people, these guys that do all this good stuff and follow the law and obey and teach the law? And you just offended the church. You just offended the synagogue, the men who teach, the holy ones. You just offended the ones who were like the holiest people around here. You don't get it, do you? He said, you just offended all those religious folks. And he answered them, every plant that my heavenly Father's not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides, and if the blind lead the blind, both will fall into a pit. But Peter said to him, explain the parable to us. And he said, are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth passes into the stomach and is expelled? But what comes out of your mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles a person. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. But to eat with unwashed hands, that doesn't defile anyone. You see that? Jesus said, it's what comes out of the heart. And he points all these things out that come from the heart. All your evil actions that come from the heart. It is the heart of a man that determines the fruit of that man's life. Do you hear me? It is your heart that will determine the fruit that is produced in your life. So if you are not seeing good fruit produced in your life, look at the heart. Because that's where your fruit comes from. Look at Matthew chapter 12. In verse 33, Jesus says, either make the tree good and its fruit good, or make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For the tree is known by its fruit. You know, we've read that before, and we think of ourselves as being the tree. Make the tree good and the fruit will be good. Make the tree, right? So make yourself good and the fruit's good. But listen, the tree is not the body. The tree is not our being. It is the heart of our being. We can take to say, make the heart good and the fruit will be good. But make the heart bad and the fruit will be bad. If you think of a tree, the tree itself has deep roots. The tree itself comes from the heart of the earth. It has deep roots. And oftentimes we need to get to those deep roots to deal with the fruit that's being produced out of an evil heart. He goes on, he says in the same scripture there, you brood of vipers, how can you speak good when you're evil? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. The good person out of his good treasure becomes brings forth good, and the evil person out of his evil treasure. Where's this treasure? The good treasure, the evil treasure. It's in the heart. The good person out of the storeroom of his heart brings out good, and the evil person out of the storeroom of his heart brings out evil. I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless word they speak. Like I said, a tree is known by its fruit, but the tree is not our being, the heart, but it is the heart of our being. So we're going to Matthew 23, verse 25. So we've read in the Beatitudes where Jesus is telling his disciple, blessed are ye who mourn, blessed are ye who are poor in spirit. He's telling bless the blessings, and in this scripture he's actually talking to the religious folks. He's giving the woes. And in verse 25 he says this: woe to you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you clean the outside of the cup and plate, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and the plate, that the outside may also be clean. Woe to you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness. So you also outwardly appear righteous to others, but within you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. Wow. And that's what Jesus meant when he was giving the Sermon on the Mount. And he said that you've heard it said, thou shalt not murder, but I tell you, don't even be angry with a brother. In other words, don't let the outward works be the only thing that looks right. Don't clean the outside. What are you talking about? He's saying don't just clean up the behaviors in your life. Don't just start doing things different because the scriptures say they're to be done different than what you're doing. Clean the inside. Look, Jesus ain't giving a lesson on dishwashing here, okay? He's talking about people. He's not talking about dishes. He said cleanse the inside. And as you clean the inside, the outside will become clean as well. If you truly have a new heart, if you truly have a pure heart, if God has done a work inside of you, it doesn't mean you're going to start doing everything perfectly, because you're not.
No.
But you will begin to see changes in your behavior when you clean the inside first. See, what happens is people come and they want to be righteous. It's just like the Pharisees. Sometimes, man, you know, we like to talk down on the Pharisees. Sometimes we ain't no better than the Pharisees. Sometimes we think, well, the Bible says don't commit adultery, don't murder, don't. So, okay, well, shoot, I'm going to make sure I don't do this and I don't do that. And the problem is you haven't done anything to change your heart. So doing that stuff, it's no good anyway. You're cleaning, you're a Pharisee. You're cleaning the outside. You're cleaning up your behaviors, but the inside's still wretched. It's putrid. He said, you're like whitewashed tombs. See what it was back in the day? In the law, you were not allowed to touch the dead. You weren't allowed to come so far from the dead because you would be defiled. And so what they would do is whitewash these tombs, or I guess wash them or paint them white, whatever. But it was a paint. Okay, they would paint these tombs white so that you could very easily see them, so that you could stay from them, so you wouldn't become defiled. So you've got these beautiful looking tombs, which inside are full of defilement. Inside are full of dead men's bones, and they're defiled. And he's comparing the people of the day, the religious people of the day, to a whitewashed tomb. You look beautiful on the outside. You got all the behaviors down. You appear to be righteous on the outside. You appear to be doing all these good things. You come to church on Sunday, and you come to Bible study on Wednesday, and you appear to be applying the things you're learning, but inside you're full of dead men's bones. You're putrid. You're defiled inside. First cleanse the inside. Because until you cleanse the inside, your outside behaviors don't mean nothing. One of our model scriptures at HHBC is in 1 Samuel 16:7, which says, "The Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Truth is, we use that scripture not necessarily in the right way that it was intended. See, we want to use that scripture, well, God looks at the heart, not the outward. We use that to as a reason why we can still dress the way we want to dress and still wear jeans when we preach and a bandana and still wear colors. But that's not what God was talking about. Now we've got to look at it a little bit differently, don't we? What he's saying? Man looks at the outward appearance. Your deeds. The things you do. Your actions, your behaviors, that's what man looks at. And even if your deeds and your actions and your behaviors look right, God's looking at your heart. It's not such a comforting scripture anymore, huh? I hear many say, well, it's okay. God knows my heart. Anybody hear that?
Oh, yeah.
To be honest, what we usually use that for is a reason to continue in the sin we don't want to get out of yet. But don't worry. I know it's wrong, but God knows my heart. Yes, he does. We want to use that God knows my heart to defend ourselves. But let me tell you what it says in Jeremiah 17:9. It says, God does know our heart. And he says that it is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. If I was you, I wouldn't be using that saying as an excuse to continue in your sin. Because you're right. God knows your heart, and that's what you will be judged by. I would rather come to my knees in repentance than continue making an excuse for why I don't want to be cleaned from the inside out. Like I said, the truth is we're all born with a serious heart condition. I'm not here to make you feel bad. But I'll tell you, I was born with the same heart condition and I suffer for it every day. But we're all born with that condition, whether you will admit it or not. David said in Psalm 51, I was born in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. It's a condition that every single one of us are born with. And through life, our hearts grow harder, colder, darker. Remember the first time I smoked pot? Man, I was a nervous wreck. My parents had me convinced if I ever smoked weed, I was going to die right away, you know? But all my friends were smoking and they wasn't dying. Boy, I was nervous taking the first hit off that joint. I felt bad, too. I lied to my parents about it. You know, I came home smelling like skunk, so I had to spray my sister's perfume on me because I ain't work alone. I come in smelling like a chick, and I'd rather tell my dad that I was with a chick than I was out smoking weed behind the shed, you know. So I'm lying already. I feel bad. I feel stupid. No, I mean literally, like when I took a hit, it hit me and I felt really stupid. I was doing stupid stuff. I felt paranoid. I thought everybody was out to get me. The second time I smoked it, though, felt a little better. Laughed a little more. Liked it a little better. Didn't really care about lying anymore because I was going to do what I wanted to do anyway by this time. Third time, lied just a little bit up. Third time, I started really liking it. By the time I was smoking four or fifth time I was smoking it, I didn't care. I was inviting my parents to come smoke it with me. You know, what I'm getting to is our hearts become hardened by our actions the more we do it. Think of the first time you told a lie. Maybe the first time that you actually lied to your a parent or something. It didn't feel good at all. You felt conviction. You felt horrible. Well, the second time that you lied to him, you still felt bad, but not quite as bad. And the third time, a little less. The fourth time, till eventually, it don't bother you to lie at all. Now you're lying to him all the time and you feel no conviction from it at all. What's happened is your heart is getting harder and harder. Every time you do it, you get another, like another form of steel encased around your heart. And so now all of a sudden you just got this solid, rock solid heart that is, it's just not soft at all toward anything. In my life, that's happened with numerous things. First time I put somebody in the hospital, I felt horrible. Second time I was bragging about it. Third time I was looking for somewhere else to put in there. Sounds horrible, but my heart was being hardened every time I acted out like that. Every one of us have a condition in the heart. It's not even just that. Things happen to us too. A lot of us had things happen to us when we were younger, or even recently. They cause you to become hard-hearted. They cause the softness of your heart to harden a little bit to where you're no longer sensitive to things you really should be sensitive to. People have been abused. People have been hurt. And it causes you to harden your heart a little bit each time. Events occur. We suffer disappointments, regrets. And before we know it, we're suffering at the very hands of broken and worldly hearts. The question is, what do we do about it? To be honest, we can't do anything about it. We can't do anything about it without the grace of God. Only God can do something about it. If you look in the book of Ezekiel, Old Testament Ezekiel, chapter 36. In verse 24, God says, I will take you from the nations and gather you from all the countries and bring you into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart and a new spirit. You hear that? God said, I will give you a heart. I will give you a new spirit. He says, I will put my spirit within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. How beautiful is God that he says, even knowing how much you've hardened your heart over your entire life, no matter what has been done to you, no matter what you have done to others, no matter what sins you've committed, no matter what struggles you've been through, God says, I know. He told Moses, when the Israelites were still in Egypt, he says, my people have cried out to me, they've been oppressed. He says, I have looked and I know. I love that scripture because it says, I know. God said, I know. Even when you try to hide that hard and stony heart from the people around you, God says, I know. I know that you have that. And he says, and I will remove that hard. I will remove that stubborn and stony heart, and I will put a new heart in you, and I will put my spirit in you. Listen, only God can do that.
Amen.
You can try and try and try by changing your behavior, but that doesn't change your heart. You can show up at biker church and say, well, this is a cool place. People dress just like me. They act just like me. They come from the same type of world, and try changing your behaviors. I'm telling you, don't come into church and start trying to change your behaviors just for the purpose of changing behaviors. Look at the condition of your heart, because without changing that, without surrendering that, you're doing yourself a disfavor. God said, I will remove your stony, stubborn heart and replace it with a heart of flesh. It will literally take an act of God. But when we truly surrender to Him and ask Him to give us a new heart, and a heart that will honor and love Him, one that will see truth and abide in His statutes, God is faithful to do exactly that. And what about the old heart, right? Does it just poof, disappear? You can fall on your knees and ask God to give me a new heart, and all of a sudden everything you've ever felt just poof in midair. Oh, man. Wouldn't it be nice? But it doesn't work that way. It doesn't, Bubba. So what about the old heart? I believe there are some things in each of our hearts that God wants us to dig up. That hurts. It is so necessary. I believe there are something in each one of our hearts that God wants us to dig up. He wants us to get to the root of it. Let me share this with you real quick. I know we're running close on time here, but we're over, so you're good anyway. I found myself on my knees praying one day, the day that I truly surrendered my heart to God. I had been a Pharisee. I'd been going to church, this mega church here in the area. Y'all know what it is, because I think there's only one. But I've been going there, and I've been doing all the right things as far as my actions. I was cleaning up my language. I was trying to do the right things, refrain from the wrong things. And basically, I'd become a Pharisee. I became a religious hypocrite. Listen, a hypocrite is not somebody who still doesn't get it right. A hypocrite is somebody who pretends to get it right and won't admit they're suffering or they're struggling. That's a hypocrite is you see the difference? A lot of people call you a hypocrite because, oh, you're a Christian, but yet you still sin, you're a hypocrite. No, that means you're still human. A hypocrite is somebody who tries to do all the right stuff on the outside without having any penetration of the heart. That's a hypocrite. And that's what I was. When I was going to church, I'd be found myself to be a hypocrite. I hadn't done any heart change, and I found myself wanting to run back to the old life. I found myself always wanting to do the old things. I wanted it. Not only was I tempted by it, I wanted it. And one day, my whole life starts falling apart. Every thing I thought I was doing right was revealed to me was none of it mattered, because I had a heart condition. See, I found myself on my knees and cried out to God, God, if you're real, I've been trying to serve you, but everything's falling apart. What's going on? I was kind of expecting God to like hear this audible voice, and it's going to be okay, Bam. Well, he don't call me Bam Bam. He said, it's going to be okay. I got this. But instead, there was no audible voice. There started coming like flashbacks. He started reminding me of things that I really did not want to remember. Things I forgot on purpose, you guys. He gave me words to write down on these big index cards. And the first one was anger. Then he started showing me why I struggle with anger. He started getting to the heart of it, to the root of it. Can I be honest with you guys? That hurt, man. Because I literally forgot some stuff on purpose. I chose to forget stuff, and God put it right back in the forefront of my mind. He says, you haven't dealt with this yet. It's still in your heart. It's still there. It has caused your heart to become encased by steel, and that's why you're so angry. And so he brought me back to when I was 11 years old. When I first found out that my father committed suicide. And for a while, I did blame my father's suicide on a lot of things, but the truth is, I made my choices back then. And that's what God began to reveal to me, is that, you know, It took a long time for me to cry about my dad. I was more angry at him because he made the choice to leave. He didn't have to die, and he knew he didn't have to die. He made a choice to die. He made a choice not to be my father. He made a choice not to be my sister's father. He did it in the garage where my bicycle and go-kart was, so you can't tell me he didn't think about me, you know, and these are the things that are going on in my mind. So I was mad, you know what? If he don't want to be a part of my life, I don't want him a part of my life. And so I decided at that point that I'll be a man, and I'll teach myself to be a man. I don't need no man to teach me. So I started bucking up to my stepdad, because I was a man now. Left home, 15, living on the streets, bouncing from friend's house to friend's house till their parents got tired of me and kicked me out. Go up to Detroit, get on the streets, wherever I could sleep that night is where I would sleep. And I was always hanging around older folks back then. Always hanging out with older dudes. Gangbangers and stuff. I didn't know it back then, but what was going on is I was looking for a father.
Amen.
I didn't know that. But I was looking for someone to teach me how to be a man. I got betrayed by one person who I thought was a friend, who was much older than me. See, by this time, when I was 15, I had already decided I didn't want to love nobody because everybody that I ever loved left. I was hanging out with this crowd of people that was all older than me, much older than me, like twice my age, got molested by one of these guys. You want to talk about rage, dude? You want to talk about wanting to murder somebody? I had to fight myself to pretend like I was still asleep so I didn't wake up and kill this dude. And at that point in time, I said, you know what? I'm never going to love anybody. I will never let anybody draw close to me like that again. And so that was what began the days of me turning every emotion I had into hate. I hated people. They didn't get the name Bam Bam because I looked like a cartoon character on the Flintstones. Now, I'm not trying to be funny either. I got it because I was a jerk. I was a ruthless renegade rebel who would go into a bar, find the biggest dude in there, no matter if he looked at me or not, smoke him, knock him out, because I hated everybody. I was full of rage and anger. And so God took me back to that moment when I found out my dad was dead. And then he took me back to that moment when I awoke and had to pretend to stay asleep so I didn't murder the dude that was molesting me. That's not something I wanted to remember. But it was still in my heart. And it was causing me to behave the way I was. You know, I could go on, and I'm not here to give my testimony. I'm sorry, I went way off track. But once you understand, that's where God has shown me we have some stuff in our heart that we really need to dig up. Because as long as that stayed there, had God not dealt with me that night on that, nothing would change. I would still be that very hateful, very angry person, full of rage that hated everybody. And God has turned me into a man who can't help but love everybody. Only God can do that. That is a new heart. Because the heart that I had didn't love nobody. The same thing with lust. I told you guys I struggled with that. You know, at a day that I was molested by a female family member that was older than me that I trusted, that day I learned to separate sex from love. They no longer had to do with the same thing. I didn't have to love a woman to have sex with her. They were two separate things. They shouldn't be. But that's what God brought me all the way back, and he showed me an incident that happened that I purposely forgot, and he made me dig it up for the purpose of dealing with it. And when I say dealing with it, I mean turning it over to him and praising him anyway. Thank you, Jesus, that you brought me through this and that you've delivered me from this and you've healed me from this. And just praising and worshiping him, and he replaces that stony, stubborn heart with a tender, responsive heart of flesh. So there's some things in your heart I believe that God wants to deal with. And when you pray and he shows you these things, don't turn an eye to them, but deal with them. Because this is how we get that new heart. And when Jesus is teaching his disciples here is without that new heart, all your outward deeds don't really, they don't add up. They don't really mean anything. All right, let me get over here. In Luke chapter 6, verse 47, it says, everyone who comes to me hears my words and does them. Everyone who comes to me and hears my words and does them, I will show what he is like. He is like a man building a house, and listen, he says, who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when a flood arose, a stream broke against that house. It could not shake it because it had been well built. But the one who hears and does not do them is like a man who built a house on the ground without a foundation. I went to this one in Luke. Yes, Jesus talks to this. He tells us the same thing on the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew. But what I love about what Luke recorded here is that he says he dug deep. Before you can build a foundation, you have to dig for that foundation. So how are we going to deal with the condition of our hearts? We're going to have to dig deep. You have to dig up some stuff you didn't want to. You dig deep and you find the root. Because let me tell you, anger, sexual immorality, theft, these things are not the cause. These are the fruit of a cause. You have to dig deeper to get to the root. You've got to dig deeper to find the cause of these things. So we have some digging to do. Don't take that clock down, man. I don't like looking at that clock. We don't need one of them. I said this with you before. I just want to reiterate. You know, I had this vision one time of a garden. And you think of a garden, and you've got this good vegetation growing out of it. But you also have these weeds that keep popping up, right? These weeds that pop up in your garden. Now, I love to garden. I could go outside, man, and pluck these weeds every day and come back, and the doggone weeds are there again. They brought seven of their friends. But if you get out there and you actually take the time to get down and dig around the weed and get down to the root and pull the root out with the weed, you find that weed can't grow back because you uprooted it. You got to the root of the weed. As long as you keep cutting off the behaviors, the root's still there for the behavior. You see what I'm saying? Until you actually take some time and get on your knees and start praying to God and asking him to help you work around this things that are going on in your life. Why are you seeing this bad fruit produced in your life? Why? What's going on? And you start doing some work and putting work into it. And he helps you, and you do it with God's help. You begin to dig and dig, and you get to that root. I'm telling you, it hurts. It takes time. It causes blood and causes sweat. But you get to the root, and you uproot that issue. That issue can no longer produce fruit in your life. But until you do that, it will always continue to produce fruit, and it'll bring friends along with it. Just want to close with this in Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy. Notice that David does not say, have mercy on me according to my works, or have mercy on me according to my righteousness. He says, have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Father, thank you, God, that you have brought the true message.